this is John Cola with GrowingYourGreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you. Today I'm actually at the Arizona Worm Farm, which is actually a cool destination farm that you guys can visit if you guys are here in Phoenix or in the Phoenix area. They have a little area for the kids to hang out in, but more importantly, you could take a self-guided tour or pick up probably the best worm castings that I've found in Arizona to date, and I doubt anybody is surpassing the quality that I've seen here. And trust me, I visited a lot of worm farms in my day, and I definitely could see how they have the best castings and even compost here in the Phoenix area. Now let me go ahead and get out of this sign, but what I will want to also tell you guys is that this company does not ship. So as much as I'm saying these worm castings are great, please do not call them and say, can you ship your castings? The answer will be no. One of the biggest goals of Zach, the owner, is to be sustainable in the local area. He is highly against, you know, getting food from thousands of miles away, and he is for growing your own food on the land. You know, his goal is to basically feed like 40 people on 10 acres of land that the food is grown right there. So everything they need is grown right there on the property. And he is working on that goal by setting up a sample 1 acre plot where he will feed one person for a full year. And so he is in process for that. So he will not ship you any castings. He will not ship you any eggs. He will not ship you any worms. He will not ship you any compost. We straight up clear, so don't even check with him. If you guys want to get this stuff, you better drive to Phoenix or fly here and then bring it back on the plane. Luckily, I drove here today and I'll be bringing back plenty of castings and maybe even some worms back to my garden to have some of the amazing worm castings and other worm products that he is making here. His process is a lot different than all the places I've visited. He combines some of the best elements that I've seen and even some of his own. So in this episode, which is not gonna be short, but this is the episode if you wanna learn how the best castings are made, how to make them yourself at home on a smaller scale, or whether you even have a business to make worm castings, how you can up your game and make higher quality worm castings. So you will wanna pay attention to this video. The final part is that at the end of this video, we're gonna get to interview Zach and we're gonna tap some of his knowledge. I was hanging out with him for the last hour or two. I learned a lot about it and I'm gonna explain his complete process if you guys wanna know. And the coolest thing about his process is that he basically, his process and all the inputs that he gets are basically free. Maybe there's a small amount that he has to pay for trucking, but basically he gets free, you know, fruit and vegetable scraps that we'll see in a minute. He gets free, you know, manure that he certifies as being clean from a local horse stable. He also gets wood chips and, you know, landscape waste from some local landscapers that have already been broken down. He also gets brewery waste that he's then recycling in to make some of his products here. So he's, you know, trying to turn in a waste stream and divert the waste stream from the landfill where it basically does nothing, makes methane gas, it actually is a hindrance, into something positive to generate an income, but more importantly, prove that he could actually just, you know, harvest a salad every day out of his garden, because that's why all this started. And then it just got bigger and bigger because he did go to school for sustainability as his second career. And he saw how sustainability taught in school was really teaching all these big concepts and how you could maybe, you know, save Walmart from using as much plastic or something. But he's like, this is not really going to help the world. So he's like started his own worm farm to basically make a difference, to basically leave the planet better than he found it. And more importantly, make it better for his grandkids that are running around, and they are the cutest things, let me tell you. So let me go ahead and take you guys around and show you guys the process. He turns waste into the best castings in Arizona. So the first step here at Arizona Worm Farm is to, number one, divert waste stream that would normally go to the local landfill. And that's what they're doing here. So here you can see they get basically a big tractor load of food scraps every week to basically end up feeding to the worms and also the black soldier flies. So you guys can see here, we basically, you know, there's a company that basically will peel pineapples, and there's cantaloupes that have been basically pre-cut and sold in packages. Normally this stuff comes in, they basically process it like the same day or the next day so that it's not sitting around collecting flies and attracting insects and wildlife. But this, batch was contaminated with plastic. Oh, muddy plastic. You know, Zach is basically a plastic phobe. He hates plastic. You know, it makes him upset when he finds plastic in his products, because his goal is to have zero plastic products in his finished products. But sometimes when it comes in, it has plastic. So then he needs to sort it out. Through every stage of his process, it is his goal to remove that plastic so that the end customer does not get it. You know, if you get plastic from Zach and the Arizona Worm Farm, you could think of yourself as like winning the lottery, because it probably rarely ever happens. All right, so yeah, they got to still sort through this. Their team tomorrow is going to come in and sort through this, get all the plastic out, and then process this to feed the worms and the black soldier flies. But it takes more than vegetable scraps to feed the worms to make them have good worm castings. It takes many other ingredients. So I'd encourage you guys, when making your castings, to use different kinds of ingredients, because the more ingredients you can provide your worms, the more different kinds of food and types of food and vitamins and minerals we could think of and nutrients for your worms, the better will castings will be, because you have a bigger diversity. So the next component besides the fruit and vegetable scraps are the wood chips or the yard waste material that has basically been ground up. This is a critical component to the composting process. You gotta have the right ratio of the nitrogen to the carbon. Now besides just the carbon, they also add other things that could add beneficial nutrients to the compost that they'll end up making to sell locally here. But more importantly, the compost they're making is to also feed their worms. So the next input they use that they want to feed in the worms and making their compost out of, that we'll see in just 1 second, is horse manure. They literally have a whole area just of horse manure. You can see like the little horse pellets as they came out of the horse's butt. Anyways, this is a very important, useful item, because otherwise it would just basically go to the landfill and get wasted. And that is what Zach is trying to do here, is divert landfill waste and use it locally so it actually gets turned into some products. And in this case, it actually will make him better worm castings. But aside from the food scraps and the, you know, carbon material and the horse manure, there's one very essential element that is required to make good high quality compost and castings. And when I see a farm use this, I'm like, this place knows their stuff. And actually he has a big pile of it over yonder. So I wanna share with you guys, because that's like the special sauce that most places don't use. So many of you guys know that I'm a big advocate of using rock dust. And yes, I use a horticultural grade rock dust. It comes in a bag in most cases, and it is quite expensive. Zach wants to use something more sustainable than that. So actually there's a local basalt quarry, which is a kind of volcanic rock. And he basically just gets the quarry dust. And this is basically rock dust. And he gets this, you know, by the big truckload for way cheaper than I could ever think about buying the agriculture grade in a bag. And in most cases, if you guys could find some kind of local, you know, ground up rocks, you know, for a lot less, it's probably better to use that than the horticulture grade I use. But I'm glad that he uses the rock dust to add to his compost, because this gives the microbes more food, you know, more minerals. It also makes the end product more nutritious, because now there's a wider spectrum of minerals than that were existing previously in just the horse manure or the fruit and vegetable scraps or the wood chips that are coming in. I'm all about diversity, and rock dust will definitely add a much larger diversity of minerals specifically, that will get broken down through the microbial process. So those source inputs are then mixed up and made into long windrows that are made with Allain Ingham standards to minimally turn them. They are turned basically 2 times during their process, so they minimally disturb them so that they have high fungal counts. This is very important. Most compost you guys buy are turned really fast, so that it is done quicker. You know, the goal here is not to produce compost quickly, it's to produce high quality compost, so it takes a little bit longer. So they do 2 major turns, and then when they harvest it, they basically harvest it and do 1 more turn, because it's turned in the process of harvesting it. This process takes quite amount of time, whereas most compost may be done in even 30 days. You know, they want to make sure it's broken down quite well, so that when they feed it to the worms, it is more easily digestible by the worms, or when they screen it out and sell it to the end users to use in your very gardens. So once the compost goes through the whole entire composting process, then some of the compost is bagged up to sell, that we'll show you guys later. Currently they're out of compost, and they are out a lot because they don't make it as fast as they sell it. But they keep some of the compost to basically feed their worms, because that's their primary use of the compost, is not to sell the public, but to feed their worms. So this is their flow through worm pile. You know, normally people think of flow through piles as like a top and a bottom. This is a side flow, flow through worm pile. This is probably the most intelligent design that I've seen. Most of the times I've been to worm farms, they basically you know, we'll feed the worms on the top, so the worms will come to the top, and then they basically need to scoop off the bottom to harvest. Sometimes the bottom is open so that the worm castings fall out the bottom, but this is even more intelligent. So this is a side flow. So what happens here is on that side that is sloped, right? Every week they maybe add like 1 inch of that compost that they made to this whole side, right? Then what happens is, imagine there's literally millions of worms in here, and I forget how many worms are in here, but there's millions of worms in here that are inside this pile that are then moving towards the brand new food that they're getting fed every week. Wouldn't you move towards the food where the food is giving out in the front of the line instead of the back of the line, right? Why be in the back of the line? You're going to be at the front of the line to get the food as it is freshly put down for you to eat. So basically the worms move over that direction and eat, but at the same time, they're not going to be on this side because this is a side that has been through the process for several months. So then like every so often they'll come down and they'll basically shave a piece off. Maybe they'll make a line right here and say, okay, we're going to harvest this whole side right here. And they harvest this much off the pile, and then they'll basically sift it out to get the worm castings. This process is specifically designed to make the highest quality castings. Oh, and I forgot to tell you guys, aside from just the compost that they put down, they also put down some black soldier flies, carcasses and their frass that they make here on site also to get some of that important chitin and chitin A's into their worm castings that are critical for plant health. So now real quick, as a side note, I want to show you guys actually how they breed their own black soldier flies to basically make a chitin-rich source of nutrients for their worms on site. They will also sell the black soldier flies to people with chickens and whatnot. Black soldier flies actually are a better breaker downer or consumer of foods. I mean, you could put, you know, you'd only feed generally worms like plant-based materials, but black soldier flies, you could put a whole chicken from Safeway in there, and literally in a couple hours, the whole chicken will be gone except for its bones. And I guess in some states, they're actually using black soldier flies to compost people when that time is ready. But anyways, some of the food scraps that come in are diverted and ground up into a slurry to feed the black soldier flies. The black soldier flies basically here eat about 100 gallons of food each week. So let's go ahead and show you guys actually what's inside this cooler here. So inside this cooler here, you can see they got 2 55-gallon drums full of basically shredded fruit and vegetable scraps. And it smells kind of, smells like a strong sauerkraut in this little refrigerated cooler here. They basically pre-grind it so they can basically take it and feed it to the black soldier flies and make the frass and their bodies to feed to their worms. So this is one of the basically shipping containers that he has converted to grow the black soldier flies. He has another shipping container dedicated to growing basically high quality worms that I may get into this episode or I may not. But anyways, in here they're basically diverting more food waste and growing the black soldier flies in a biopod and some other different kind of totes. So you can see they're basically feeding the soldier flies in here when they're little larvae. And the cool thing is they actually have a whole system that I'm not going to show in this video where they actually will breed the soldier flies out from the larvae until when they pupate. And then when they pupate, they'll basically turn into flies and then they'll breed. Then they'll collect the seeds. So in this little jar collection bin thing here, they got all the black soldier fly larvae. And if you guys look closely, they are alive. They're moving around. They feel so weird in my hand. I mean, imagine dumping these on somebody's stomach. And there's one that just hatched out, actually. So man, they are so weird and creepy and crawly. But these guys, when they're a little bit younger, juveniles, they eat a lot. And here's a guy that wants to fly away. That's a black soldier fly. So if you guys see any of these things in your compost, and they will regularly come in my compost, I'm actually quite happy that they're there. You know, they are part of the nature system to basically degrade and break down food waste. And we should use nature's methods to break down food waste like the worms, like the soldier flies and other little creatures instead of send food waste off to the garbage landfill that does absolutely nothing. So after the worms have gone through the compost and they harvest it off that side, like I showed you guys, it goes into basically a big cart like this. And this is basically the finished worm castings, but it's with the bedding material. So there's big, large chunks. You know, it wouldn't be right if they just sold you these big, large chunks. So Zach got a really cool tool. This is something I need. It's an awesome sifter because it's actually a two-stage sifter. So what happens is we're gonna go ahead and put this material on the top of the sifter. and we're gonna turn it on in a second, but it gets kind of loud, so I wanted to explain what it does. Anyways, it has two screens. It has like maybe a quarter inch screen on the top here and an eighth inch screen. So as this turns on, you'll see in a minute, it shakes. So it vibrates all this. It's at a little bit of an angle. So all the big material, the woody material that's not fully broken down yet, will then basically go back to their composting to get composted fully down. The next level will basically get sifted out, and some of this could maybe be used in like their raised bed mix or other uses. And then finally, the castings with the little cocoons or the worm eggs drop to the bottom and then get put into the bin over there that I'll show you guys in a minute. So we're gonna go ahead and turn this on and show you guys how this works. So basically, you cut the down and it gets sucked down into the bottom. This conveyor belt thing comes on and then it conveys it all up into this little bin right here. And inside this bin is the fresh worm castings, you know, with a little bit of bedding material with high fungal action. And this stuff, they keep it moist, so they actually have a burlap cover on it, so they can actually keep a nice environment. Now, the cool thing about the Arizona worm farm is that they are a big believer, as I am, that, you know, worm castings in plastic bags that have been sitting in a plastic bag for months does not have the biologic activity that a fresh worm casting that literally just came out of the worm's butthole, wait, do they have a butthole? has. You know, so their goal is to basically harvest the casting and then sell it to you within 7 days. And they're not even gonna, you know, if they're not selling castings, they're not even gonna harvest castings until they need it. You know, where they're gonna actually use it on site in their garden that we're gonna look at in a little bit. But these castings are really nice. And the cool thing is, during this whole process, other than the input food scraps that came in, there's really low smells here. You know, when you have smells when you're composting, that means you're doing it wrong. You know, there's a composting company in Nevada, in Las Vegas, that made me remove their video that I made at their facility because I said the compost smelled, and that's a sign that they are not doing it right. If I take and smell this stuff, there's like basically like that much smell. And what does it smell like? It smells like the forest floor. It smells nice and earthy. This is not super wet. You don't want castings like super wet. You don't want them super dry either. This is the nice texture where if you squeeze it together really hard, it'll kind of ball up, but the instantly you touch it, it falls apart. This is exactly the kind of castings you want to buy. They also do testing on this to show that they have high fungal and bacterial levels on these castings quite often. So we're gonna go ahead and cover this back up so we can protect their castings so that the customers here get the best worm castings in Arizona. So Zach's goal is to create a closed loop system where they produce enough nutrients for the plants they grow here so they could actually live off the food. And yes, you know, to me, they have a much larger garden than they need to grow to eat. So they also will maybe sell some of the garden stuff, the vegetables produced, or maybe donate it sometimes. For me, I would probably try to process it and just use it. If I had this much kale, which actually in some times of the year I do, I juice a lot of it. I also will dehydrate it into kale juice. Be sure to check my videos down below, how to turn your kale, which is, this is all nice red Russian kale, into kale chips, how you can use your kale to ferment it into sauerkraut, you know, how I juice it. I literally can juice 2 pounds of kale and it makes literally 16 ounces of juice, which is nothing. And then guess what? All the fiber that comes out of the juicer can then get fed back to the worms to feed them, or you know, to the other the compost piles. So I really want to encourage you guys to use more of the food you grew, because guess what? More of the food you eat here, more calories and more especially nutrients, micronutrients versus macronutrients that are coming from your garden, that means the less food you will have to buy and import from somewhere else. But that's one of Zach's main things. And actually the way he's built the soil here, and I'll show you guys in a minute, he has two buckets. You know, one bucket is a bucket of literally sand, you know, and here in Phoenix, like the soil is like really sand, caliche, or could be clay, but he has literally sand. This was formerly cotton growing fields that are growing GMO cotton using nasty chemicals that he's basically remediated by bringing in the beneficial soil microbes, the beneficial fungi and bacteria and even archaea that are just, in the system inherently. So that's really cool that he's able to basically build soil and have healthy vegetables. Now, the thing he mentioned to me, which I also know, which most gardeners do not know, is that it's very important to have a high fungal component to your soils. You know, we don't want to have a fungal dominant soil for growing vegetables, but we have a lot higher fungal content that is normally found in soils, especially bag soils of today. And that's why worm castings and probably made fungal compost is quite necessary. Of course, the easiest way to make a proper fungal compost for your garden is to do leaf mold composting or to use wood chips and let them break down over several years in a cold pile to make high fungal content that then you could add to your garden. Of course, he has a big worm farm, so you know I'm confident he has the best growing vegetables, and actually I want to put him to the test. We're going to go ahead and taste one of his red Russian kale leaves, and I'm a taste tester. I know what things taste like. We were talking earlier about how a tomato you grew yourself tastes better than the store, but even things like kale can taste better if you grew it yourself than the stuff you're getting at the store that has been picked, you know, a week or two ago, put in cold storage, then shipped to you. The nutrients degrade, and even some of the anti-cancer benefits can be literally gone out of the kale that you're buying in the store, you know, if you didn't pick it fresh and eat it. Plus, of course, plants that have higher nutrition, taste sweeter, and has more minerals in it. You know, I have to say, actually, that's some quite good kale. I feel like the kale bite, and that's because it is heating up right now here in Phoenix, but it has a nice, really nice mild flavor, and I taste a really richness that I just don't get from store-bought kale. I would definitely say it even rivals the kale I grow. Delicious. So I want to encourage you guys, you know, if you guys live here in Phoenix, you want to get some of his castings, get some of his compost tea that he also makes on Saturdays that we'll talk about in a minute, to enrich your garden and get some of that that fungi action in your garden that is especially important in the desert Southwest. So if you guys come to the Arizona Worm Farm, you could do your own self-guided tour, and they have like signs that are actually they're currently redoing right now. But the main reason you want to come here is actually to pick up some of their compost or even raised bed mix or the worm castings that I showed you guys already. So this is like, I'm going to show you guys now the store area and how you could come here and buy it. They will not ship this stuff, so do not call them and ask them. I know somebody will end up doing that. I want the stuff. They will not ship it. Fly to Arizona or drive here. You could pick it up yourself. Anyways, over here they sell actually a good clean mulch in bags. Zach is really against plastic bags, so he's trying to find an alternative for the plastic bags that he can pack his products in. So if you know one, post a comment down below so he can read it and I can pass it along to him. That's very important to him as well as for me. We want to reduce the plastic consumption, you know. There's a conspiracy out there, and the conspiracy says, stop using plastic straws because now you're killing the sea fish in the seas and the oceans. Well, plastic in the oceans, because I watched Seaspiracy last night, counts for 0.003, or a very small amount of the pollution of plastic in the ocean. Most of the plastic pollution in the ocean is caused from fish netting that's made out of plastic. So if you really want to save the fish, stop buying fish so that the fishermen are not in there dumping their freaking plastic netting to mess up the fish ecosystem and also all the bycatch that are being, you know, killed off. Anyways, back to the video. He also sells us homemade compost. He would rather sell to you guys in bulk, so I'm going to show you guys actually how you could buy this stuff in bulk instead of by the bag, which I would actually recommend for you guys. So if you guys want to buy your own compost or mulch from the Arizona Worm Farm, the better way to do it is to buy it in bulk. So if you got a truck, surely you could drive in. He'll bring up the loader and dump it in your truck, although he does not have a lot of compost in bulk to sell at this time, so make sure you call him first. Right now, as I'm making this video, he's out, so he has a very limited amount of a few bags left. But if you guys are going to come and just buy a small amount, instead of buying them by the bag and wasting the plastic, you should get it in the U-Scoop. So he set up an area, and I think every place should have something like this, where you could come in, and you could basically just take a bucket, and you could scoop the bucket into your own containers. So you could fill up your own containers. You know, whether you want to bring plastic totes, whether you want to bring feed sack bags, whether you want to bring just 5-gallon buckets that you fill up, you know, whether you want to line the back of your car with a tarp and just dump it in there, right? This is a better way to buy your compost because you will not have to use any plastic. And also, too, for me, you know, it's easier to buy it in bulk as well because I don't have to deal with opening plastic bags. And the other thing is, like us, compost wants to breathe. As you know, it's a safety hazard for small children to put plastic bags over their heads because they can suffocate. We could all suffocate. And guess what? Living compost, will suffocate in a plastic bag and you will lose probably some diversity of microbes. So I encourage you guys not to do it and buy things in bulk whenever possible. A lot of my nuts and seeds and other bulk dry foods are bought in bulk whenever I can, but due to COVID, they seem to be packing everything up, which I'm not a fan of. So Pride for Home garners the biggest resource he has that's just made for you guys, and something he has a whole bunch of, because he has actually two pallets here, plus all this over here. And this actually is even better than just buying his compost, because this is basically a ready mix for growing a raised bed garden, which is what I recommend. The previous video I showed the best way to keep worms is in a raised bed garden. To fill your raised bed garden, don't buy the garbage stuff at Home Depot or Lowe's. You know, there's the bag mixtures. Those are not composted properly. They don't have the right mixtures and they're quite old. He makes these batches up fresh. And this is actually his raised bed mix from Arizona Worm Farm. It contains compost, coconut coir, vermiculite, worm castings, and basalt dust. So it has my main ingredients that I like the most, you know, including the worm castings, which are the highest quality worm castings that I ever found in Arizona, as well as the rock dust or the basalt dust that he has in there. Plus, he has the vermiculite and the coconut coir, which, you know, Mel Bartholomew of Square Foot Raised Bed Gardening would recommend. So this is like an ideal mix to buy to fill up all your raised beds and even your little potters and plants. But now we're gonna go over the creme de la creme, the worm castings, and actually the worms he sells. If you wanna create your own worm bin, like in plastic, which I do not recommend, or even better yet, a raised bed worm bin. All right, so this is the little store, and they have a sign, masks are required at all times. Luckily, I'm here on their day off, so I'm glad that Zach was able to accommodate me on the day off so I could film around without a mask on. But inside here, this is where they sell their worm castings, and they sell their worm castings a lot different than any other place I've ever been. You know, most places will sell their worm castings in plastic. The place in Texas that I went to that also has very high quality worm castings, probably the best in Texas, check the link down below for that video, sells their worm castings like fresh harvested in burlap sacks so the castings can breathe, plus you don't have plastic waste. And here at the Arizona Worm Farm, they found these perfect sized boxes that they basically fill up with the worm castings, and they fill them fresh. So these are all fresh. They're filled up to the top, and they sell basically worm castings by the box. Once you use these worm castings, you can then compost the box. You can shred out the box and use it as bedding to feed your worms. If you don't do anything with these castings, you maybe water a little bit, the castings have eggs in there, which will then hatch, and then the worms will end up eating the box. So many uses of the box, they're quite handy. So this is how they, you know, sell their castings. Now, once again, they do not ship these guys. These guys are too heavy, and you know, I don't think Zach would do that because he can't even support the local area because there's such a demand for his good quality worm castings that he cannot even meet. He's not even gonna think about shipping them. That will be unsustainable. He would rather teach you guys how to start your own Arizona worm farm that you couldn't call that Arizona worm farm near you and duplicate his exact process so that you could divert more food waste out of the waste stream and make high quality castings near you, which is a much more sustainable system, and that is what he is about. He shares his techniques and his process on various worm forum websites so that people could duplicate what he's doing here so that the world can become, you know, basically more sustainable, have less food waste, and close the waste cycle. So besides selling the worm castings, what they also do here is they will sell the worms. So unlike a lot of farms that I've visited, right, they just don't sell you worms from their castings that they sift out or screen out. Different process. Actually, they grow fat worms here that are quite happy, large, and healthy, specifically for selling to you guys. Maybe in another video when I come back, I'll do that, but my main focus is the gardening and how can this benefit gardeners. And definitely by growing the best worms, by basically breeding worms. They have a whole worm breeding room, which, you know, they basically breed worms just for the fact of making high quality and fat worms. They then put those worms in a different area and give them a different diet that is specifically designed to fatten them up so they will be nice, fat, and healthy. In addition, when they create worms for sale, they don't just sell worms that are all one age. They sell juvenile babies. They sell, you know, middle-aged babies worms, and they have adult baby worms. How are they all babies? And they also sell the worm cocoons or the eggs in that batch. So what they do is they bring in the that stuff into these bins here. They fill up these bins, and they'll basically bag it up for you guys in these sacks. So inside these sacks has the bedding and the worms in there. This is not sold by the pound. It's just sold by the bag, and there's about 500 to 700 worms in here, plus all their little cocoons, so they're going to hatch more. But more importantly than just the cell buying the worms loose right? It's not a good way to buy worms loose because the worms, you're taking them out of their environment. Imagine buying a fish from the fish store and they just put it in a bag with no water. That's how you're buying worms. You're just buying loose, packed in worms without any kind of bedding material, right? Always when you go to the pet store and you're buying a fish, they give you some of the water, maybe even out of the tank that you just bought it from, so the fish could swim around in its own environment, in its own, you know, area that it's been living in, its own microclimate, you know, and that's what they're doing here. They basically just use the bedding that they've been living in for the last, whatever months to sell to you guys. So let me show you guys what that actually looks like, because they got a bin right here. So now I'm going to show you guys what you're going to get if you actually buy worms. So this is actually the worms with the bedding material in this little tray here. So we're going to go ahead and scoop some of these guys up and see what we got. So inside here, you could clearly see there's like some larger worms and there's some smaller worms like crawling around, like different sizes, little babies. I mean, we might have to scoop some more up to see more of them. But more importantly, you got, oh, here's a little baby right there. You got little worm cocoons in there. Oh, there's a little baby. Look at that. Look at that little guy. There's a bigger one right there. I mean, this is quite active. In addition, they have all their bedding material, which is like, you know, like their bed where they would live, and then also the food that they would eat in here to support them. So literally, once you buy these guys, they're adapted to this environment. You would then take this and put it into your raised bed to inoculate the worms in your raised bed. And as long as you keep your raised bed, you know, topped off with organic matter, they could eat. But better yet, you want to make what I showed you guys in the last episode. I'll put a link down below. Basically a raised bed that you could keep worms in where they have a feeding station, and you basically just feed the feeding station once a week with some, you know, yard waste or some browns and some food scraps, and you can keep these guys alive and they could literally work for you and make you fertilizer, right? This is, I mean, literally for me, worms are the best fertilizer producers on the planet. You feed them, they make fertilizer so that you don't have to fertilize your plants. I really wanted to get you guys out of the mindset that I need to fertilize my plants. No, if you have good soil, a good soil food web, your soil food web will make the nutrients that your plants need so that you no longer need to fertilize them. But, you know, nobody at Home Depot will ever tell you that because they want to say the 10-10-10 fertilizer or even the organic fertilizer. I want you guys to set up your garden so that it makes its own fertilizer. And that is basically what I've shared with you guys today here at Arizona Worm Farm. He's doing the hard work to convert all the food waste, the horse manure, the wood chips, the rock dust that he uses into basically fertilizer for your plants. And in addition, if you want to do it yourself, you could buy the worms, high quality worms, same breeding stock that he uses to make his worm castings for your garden. I think the final part of this episode is I want to go ahead and interview Zach. He's a pretty, he's a very intelligent guy and he knows a lot. And, you know, at first when I got here, I was talking more and usually I'm listening more, but he wanted to know what I knew. And just by questioning him and asking him a lot of questions, he definitely knows his stuff. And I'm glad that he was able to have me out today. So let's go ahead and interview Zach, the owner here at Arizona Worm Farm, for you. So now I have the pleasure of interviewing for you guys, Zach Brooks, owner and founder of the Arizona Worm Farm here. And I would say basically soil master extraordinaire. I don't know if he would say that, but I'm going to say that because this guy, he knows a lot. I mean, I'm not often impressed by people, but I'm impressed by Zach and what he's doing here, how he's doing it, and all the little fine kind of like engineering skills. And some of you guys will get that because like my grandfather was an engineer and I kind of have an engineering mind despite never getting a, you know, higher degree than a bachelor's in science for business. So I really see some of the processes and systems and why what he's doing here in Arizona to make the best quality castings is really the best castings. So I got a couple questions that I want to ask him today. And the first question is, Zach, why an Arizona worm farm here in Phoenix, probably one of the hottest places in the country, one of the places that you probably shouldn't have worms because they could overheat. They like it maybe around, I don't know, right around 80, maybe a little bit cooler than 80 degrees optimally. And, you know, it's very arid and it's dry and, you know, worms and microbes and plants like things where it's moist. I don't know, it seems like a big challenge to me. So why'd you do it?
Well, the Arizona Worm Farm is here because I was born and raised in Arizona, and I'm convinced that you can create a sustainable, healthy environment in Phoenix, Arizona, in spite of the temperature extremes. And my goal is to create an environment where we can demonstrate that you can live comfortably in the desert, create microclimates that allow you to grow lots of different things, And that really starts with worms. So Charles Darwin was fascinated by worms because they add so much to the soil. And so part of what we're trying to do is to bring that life back to the soil.
And I would completely agree with him. I mean, in my research and from what I've seen, worms are a critical component to having healthy soils. I mean, they are literally one of the driving factors in soils. Now, there's many others, of course, but especially here in the desert. Maybe some of you guys have been to Phoenix or the Southwest. Literally, it's called the Desert Southwest for a good reason, because the soil here is not soil. I mean, we are not in a nice, you know, loamy soil that's rich with organic matter. It's basically like, it's better than Florida. So you guys in Florida are more screwed than we are, but this is pretty sandy, lots of minerals, but basically very low, if any, organic matter in most cases. So bringing back the organic matter through the composting that he's doing here and the worms is super critical. So another thing that's really apparent to me, Zach, is that, you know, you're trying to really divert waste going from the landfill. You're literally diverting garbage that would go to other people's garbage. You know, what do they say? Other person's garbage, another man's treasure. And literally you are using garbage that would normally get taken to the landfill, disposed of, and using it to turn into a valuable product for people. But more importantly, as we're sitting here in the garden, grow some amazing food, which all you guys that live in Phoenix could do. You know, Zach is special, but you know, he's not, you know, you could garden too, right? It's not that hard. You just need to set up your systems right. He's very smart about that, and he makes the products available so that you guys could do that.
Right, so there's an old dad joke that says, why do frogs live stress-free lives? And the answer is because they eat what bugs them. Well, garbage always bugged me, and so everything here at the farm is aimed at turning garbage into food. And so we take waste something like 200 yards a week out of the waste stream, out of the landfills where it would turn into methane gas, and we use it here to grow healthy organic food.
So you couldn't have said that any better. And while he does this on a massive scale, I want you guys to empower yourselves, that each of you guys could, you know, if everybody didn't send their garbage to the landfill and took care of it themselves, each person, then, you know, somebody like, we could put Zach out of business, you know? So like on my house, I never send any food scraps off my property. Any food I don't eat goes directly in my compost pile. You could have your own compost pile. You could have your own worm bin. You know, you could just dig a hole and bury your food scraps, and the worms will probably end up finding it, unless it's too dry, like in the desert, and it'll just dry out. But then it'll get eaten by some at some point in time.
There's another really important aspect to what we're doing, and that is that you look around here, but the truth is I was always a terrible backyard gardener. I would spend $300, $400, $500, $600 in raised beds and mix and fertilizer, and I'd get two sickly tomatoes and wonder what I was doing wrong. And what I found out, the more I learned about soil, is that if I use that garbage and the microbes and worms and macro and microfauna, the soil got rich and it got alive, and vegetables grew easily. So it's a much, much easier way to garden, and it gets rid of garbage.
That's cool. Yeah, I mean, basically we want to let nature do all the work. I mean, I made a recent video and I said, let nature steer. We try to micromanage our plants, our gardens, and put in these fertilizers and all these things that are not natural. But guess what? Worms live in the soil. You know, compost will happen. Spread out compost, spread out worm castings, get some worms in your soil. So I want to talk to you, Zach, real quick about my last episode. If you guys seen it, if you didn't see it, post the link down below. I'll even I'll pin it to the first comment. So I want you guys to watch that. But it's basically the best worm bin. And this is a thought that I've had, but I'm glad you have been doing this and proving it for the last 4 years on the best worm bin. It's not made out of plastic. It's simply a 4-foot by 4-foot raised bed garden. So you want to explain that and the concepts behind that real quickly for my people that didn't see my last video?
Yeah, so super simple. We create a habitat for the worms within these large gardens and within our raised bed gardens. We put just a thin layer of mulch or cardboard at the bottom to provide for some drainage. We add the worms, and then we just layer in green waste and brown waste, about an inch of each week. The worms consume that, they decompose it, they poop out microbes like crazy. The microbes inhabit the entire area, and the fruits and vegetables grow from the compost that we put in there. It means that we can grow fruits and vegetables where we don't have to fertilize them in a classic sense of fertilization. All we do is continue to add green waste and brown waste, some nitrogen and carbon, and the worms will convert that into available nutrients for plants to grow.
Yeah, I mean, it's super simple. I mean, basically, you're feeding your fruit and vegetable scraps to grow more fruits and vegetables so you could actually just close the loop and grow what you need. I mean, that's why I have a huge garden in my backyard so I could grow the food I eat. I mean, of course, the food you grew also tastes a lot better. So, Zach, I want to get into some of the products here that you're offering to the public. So, number one, the compost. You guys saw earlier how the compost is made. But what makes your compost superior to other composts that are available, say, at a big box store?
Right. So, we do a number of things that, while they're not unique, we think they're very special. We layer in a variety of different organic materials, pre-composted horse manure, food waste, vegetable waste, fruit waste, and ground landscape waste. We're very, very careful about measuring temperatures so that it heats up. We turn it appropriately and let it cool down. Once it's finished its heating and cooling cycles, we try as hard as we possibly can to just leave it alone and let the fungal development continue undisturbed. So you can make compost faster, but we don't think you can make it any better. And we add some basalt dust for mineralization. We add insect waste into a lot of our products to provide, to tell plants in advance that there might be some pests there, so plants protect themselves from the inside out. But mostly it's about time and the right amount of moisture and the right of attention to temperature.
Yeah, I mean, I would completely agree. I mean, this guy knows fungal compost, and that's important to do it right. And most places, once again, just get waste material in compost and sell it to you so they can make a fast buck. And, you know, this guy's doing it right. And trust me, I visit a lot of places. So next, Zach, I want to ask you about the worm castings, which, you know, your castings, based on what I'm seeing in your process and learning your entire process, is like, it's got to be some of the best castings I've seen so far, although I haven't seen the data on it, but I definitely trust your word that it is definitely high fungal comparatively to other castings that are normally available at your local nursery. So what makes your castings different than others?
Yeah, so there's three or four things that I'm particularly proud of with our castings. The first is we have a diversity of food stocks. So the inputs that are going into them, it's not just paper pulp or something that decomposes quickly. It's hardwoods and softwoods. It's vegetable and fruit waste. It's different manures. We add, again, insect bodies, the shells of insects, in order to encourage fungal development. We have the addition of lots of carbon that creates, a fungally dominant casting, and we take a really long time doing it. It takes us between 6 and 9 months to get a casting ready to the point that we think it's ready for backyard gardens. And probably the single most important thing about buying castings is when you buy them from us here, they were in our wedges just 24 hours earlier. So you're getting a fresh, active castings. The benefit from castings is not so much in the fertilizer value, you know, the NPK. It's in the microbial balance that's in those castings. It's the bacteria and fungi and nematodes that will interact with the organic material in your soil to provide a slow drip of important food for your plants. So those things, they're living, breathing organisms. They need air and they need water. And so we keep them as fresh as we possibly can in our wedges, and then we send them out the door the next day so that when you get it in your garden, it's still microbially rich.
Yeah, I mean, that's actually something that not many other places, maybe like one other place that I visited, is really aware and keen on. So this is quite uncommon. Now, the other thing I will say is that, you know, if you get onto a local nursery and buy worm castings at a nursery versus, you know, getting Zach's here at Arizona Worm Farm, they both say worm castings, but the quality is vastly different. And I understand the difference because I've seen the process, but what you guys don't know is, you know, what are worms fed on other worm farms? You know, I've called and checked some of the worm castings that are sold at Walmart, that are sold at Costco, and I've tried to contact those companies and ask them, what do you feed your worms? And what do they reply to me? Well, many of them don't reply. The ones that do say, it's proprietary. What does that mean? Why are they not wanting to share with me? And here's the truth of the matter is. The truth of the matter is many worm castings that you find, you know, at the store to buy are basically, the side product of maybe the fishing industry that are growing big plump worms to grow for worms, and they're basically optimized their growing of the worms to make large worms, not good quality worm castings for gardeners. You know, whereas here, and I didn't really cover it this much in this episode, you know, is Zach has two tracks. He has one track to make the highest quality castings for gardeners, which is what I talked about today in this video. Maybe another time I come back, I'm going to talk about, you know, how he grows the plumpest, fattest, healthiest worms so you guys can get your own worms in your garden. He does that in a totally different way. He doesn't feed them the same inputs that he does to get nice fat worms. He does not sell the castings that those worms make. Actually, that's part of their bedding material that you will buy that the worms are living in, so you'll have a higher level of success if you try to, you know, keep worms yourself. So you want to talk, Zach, about the worms that you grow for selling to get out to people so that they can start consuming their and using their own food waste on site.
Right. So our favorite thing to do is to sell red wiggler compost worms. It's a breed of worm that operates between 30 degrees and 90 degrees quite healthily. In Arizona, we never worry about the soils getting too cold. We have some strategies on how to keep them cool, but what we have them out here outdoors 7 days a week, 365 days a week, 365 days a year. They live fine outside. So we breed composting worms for you to take home. It's absolutely the best way to get castings in your garden over a long period of time. You buy them one time, you just keep feeding them. They'll permeate your gardens. They don't have teeth, so they won't eat your radishes or your beets or your turnips. But anything that dies, they'll eat. They'll poop out microbes and help to make sure that you can convert what's in your soil into what your plants need at the time that your plants need them.
Yeah, and I would encourage you guys that. So like the goal is if you're gonna come here and you have a garden, right? Buy the worms instead of the castings, right? Because you can make your own, but it's very important. If you want good quality casting, you gotta make sure the worms you buy, you feed them properly, and you wanna emulate and duplicate what Zach's doing here, or you might as well just also buy his castings at the same time. So Zach, another thing I heard actually, since you're the worm guy, I wanna ask you this question. So there's some people up in Las Vegas that say, our worms are, you know, kept outside all year long, so we have, you know, heat-tolerant worms. Is there such a thing as worms that have maybe adapted to living in hotter climates than, you know, than normal? What's the answer?
So red wigglers is a fairly well-known and consistent breed, and the red wiggler that you buy in Phoenix is the same as the red wiggler that you buy anyplace else. There's a noticeable difference in Arizona outside worms in that they tend to be skinnier. So if you come here, and we love for you to come down, we'll give you a tour, we'll show you around. If you look at our breeding worms that are kept in an air-conditioned box, they're bigger and fatter. They look like they're healthier. They're not any healthier, they're just bigger and fatter because they don't have to deal with the outside extremes. So the worms that you buy from us are going to be a little bit skinnier because they are raised outside and they'll shed some water weight. So the breed is the same. The only difference is that they get, they kind of fine-tune their body for Arizona heat.
So another question, Zach, because, you know, I know in the summer here it could get well over 100 degrees, south of 110 degrees actually, and you said worms like to maybe live up to 90 degrees. So what are some mitigation techniques for people to use should they buy your worms? They live here in Phoenix or live in a hot southwest climate because they don't want their worms to lose their little worm lives.
Right, so a couple of things that we do. First, understand that worms will try and find their happy place. Yeah. And even though it's 110 degrees outside, if you're growing like we are under 50% shade, if you're watering regularly, the ambient temperature of the ground is gonna be closer to 80, 85 degrees. And so the worms will find a happy place within that ground. Here on our big wedges, we add a light layer of mulch in the summertime, and we water once or twice a day, and that evaporation from the mulch cools the core temperature of the wedges. In our raised bed, in the in-bed composting systems, we dig down 4 to 6 inches actually into the ground. We make it light and fluffy, and the worms in the summertime will move down into that space. If you grab a handful of our wedge today on a nice cool day, the worms are all up at the top feeding on that aerobic material. The summertime, you got to dig down 6 or 8 or 10 inches to find them, because they'll be down in where the core temperature of the wedges are a little bit smaller. So shade is really helpful. If you have a bin, a worm bin that's not in the ground, if you'll get a piece of burlap, a little bit longer than the bin, run that burlap across the top of the bin and set it in a jar of water. That water will wick through the burlap and it'll cool it nicely. The last technique that we use is a water bottle rotation, and people find this to be quite successful. Get a water bottle, drink it down 2 or 3, 4 inches, put the cap on tight and put it in the freezer, let it freeze hard. When it freezes hard, take it and stick it in your water bin, in your worm bin. Take 2 or 3 days for that water to melt. Take it out, rinse it off, put it in the freezer, and just repeat that. You do that 6, 7, 8, 10 times over the summer and your worms will do fine. You can provide them with a little air conditioning unit and they do fine. It takes some focus. You got to pay attention to them. They're just like pets. They need to be fed and watered, and you got to monitor temperature. But again, that's why we like those outdoor bins. If you're growing something outdoors in Arizona, again, if you have it in the shade, the worms will find a happy place where it's comfortable for them. I'll tell you one other thing. The worms, in their actively breeding stages, will produce a cocoon about once a week, and those cocoons will fall down in. The cocoons won't hatch unless the temperature and habitat conditions are right. So the worms will lay eggs, produce cocoons and lay eggs in those cocoons during April, May, and June. They won't hatch when it's really, really hot. So you may see less worm activity here outdoors in August, but September, October, they come roaring back.
Wow, yeah, definitely excellent tips that I never learned. I really like the tip about that burlap sack in a little thing of water, and then it just basically self-wicking to cool. Now, the other thing as a gardener, what I would say is, you know, we're sitting here in the garden, and you could see, you know, Zach plants things really closely, and the planting of plants really closely is providing a nice, basically, cover. Or think of a forest. When you go into the middle of a forest, it's all shade down below the forest. So, you know, he's just creating, just through growing of plants, a lot of shading of the soil. So maybe potentially a shade cloth might not even be necessary if you have a nice lot of shade, like underneath the tree. And once again, I like to have worms in the ground where they could find where they need to be to get out of the heat. You're right. I mean, when I take my dog for a walk in the middle of the summer, right? He's smart. He sees, oh, next to that side of the street has a shade and this side is open. He'll walk to that side and I don't have to tell him that. Then I just, okay, he leads me into the shade. So Zach, and I know another thing about you is more being more sustainable on the planet and leading like a zero waste lifestyle. So what's a message about the zero waste lifestyle that you'd like to share with my viewers? Something that they could do today to get them on their path to being more zero waste.
So the very best compost you can make for your garden comes out of the plants, the things that you grew in your garden. So we like using our composting and worms to take our waste and reuse it completely to grow more food. We believe that if you think about how you want to recycle, reuse, compost every bit of your waste, then maybe you'll stop buying as much stuff that can't be reused. I saw a meme the other day about somebody who said, well, throw it away. Well, where's away? There isn't an away. And so we think that these processes and practices are essential to figuring out how to get to zero waste and live comfortably. I don't want to sweat in a yurt and starve. I want to live comfortably and I want to eat good food, and we think this will get that across.
Yeah, I mean, everybody could just do one step at a time, you know, to get to more of a zero waste. Yeah, buy less plastic, you know, buy things in bulk when you're able to, you know, grow your own food so there's no packaging involved with that. You know, recycle all your food waste and your food scraps on site and compost them using, you know, a standard pile or a fungal pile or even with the worms are excellent techniques to do that. So the next part, Zach, because I know people are going to ask, why don't you ship anything? I have people all over the world that probably want your castings now because I've been here and I've seen it and I know how good quality, and I'm definitely driving home with some today and some worms. Why don't you ship anything?
Well, my best reason is that we have limited capacity, and so we sell as much of the product as we can make here to backyard gardeners in Phoenix. So we've been very fortunate that the local backyard community has supported us. So we just don't have the capacity to send stuff out. But the second reason is more philosophical. We really believe that the best fruit that you can eat is the fruit that you can grow in your yard today. The best castings you can produce are the ones that you can get in your local area. Almost wherever you are, there's somebody who's producing locally a good quality compost and a good quality casting. Go find them, patronize their businesses, help them grow and be successful. That's really what we want to achieve.
Yeah, I mean, I would totally agree with that. We need more local food systems, whether that's a worm food system or, you know, food system for us. You know, my vision for the future is seeing like a farm, like literally on every block, and maybe even a composting facility with worms on every single block in large cities so that the food could be produced locally and all your waste could just go to that one house, and that's the guy, the crazy dude that keeps worms or compost that and then turns it into soil that then can be used on the farm that's making the food next door, or even back out to the neighborhood to basically grow your own fertilizer, so then we have to have fertilizer trucks shipping fertilizer all over the country, which to me is just insane. Now the other thing that I really like about you, Zach, is that basically you're making all your all your research and what you've learned, you're sharing this information with others so that if somebody is interested in, you know, creating something like Arizona Worm Farm near them to once again make it more sustainable so that everybody could do this, you're doing that. So how are you sharing your information in case one of my viewers want to start their own Arizona Worm Farm? They could call it, you know, Florida Worm Farm or whatever near them.
Right, so there's a Facebook group called the Worm Farmers Alliance, and we share all of our information that way. If you're really serious, send me an email. I'll send you a bunch of information. We are thrilled to share what we've learned with as many people as possible. Again, we'd like to see local growth of local composting, local worm castings, local waste reduction. We think that makes the most sense.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. And also just the carbon emissions from shipping, you know, food all over the world, or more importantly, worm castings that are heavy all over the country, not as sustainable as, you know, number one, make them yourself, guys. It takes time to make good quality castings. I've showed you the process. You could duplicate the process from what I've showed you here. So start doing it yourself. And otherwise, you know, maybe start your own in your area if you're really passionate about the worms and making it available for people in your local area. And once again, doing a good job to pat yourself on the back by diverting food waste and other waste products from going to the landfill. So, Zach, are there any final words of wisdom you'd like to drop on my viewers today before we sign off?
Just if you're in the Phoenix area, come visit us. We love to show off the farm.
Cool. And what are the days and hours that you're open? At present time, this may change.
Right. We're open Monday through Friday from 8 to 4 and Saturday from 8 to 1. In the summertime, we close on Mondays and we open from 7 to 2.
All right. Wonderful. Yeah, I'll put a link down below to the website that has information as well as a link to their YouTube channel, where Zach makes these really cool informative videos, you know, here and there to share with you guys more about the worms, more about the composting and how to reduce your food waste and all that stuff. So definitely I've had a fun time here. So I thank Zach for having me out today on a Sunday. And this is his day to spend with his grandkids. So his grandkids are running around and it really motivated me to maybe grow some kids in my future. I just still need to find my partner because it's like I just saw the joy in his eye. I mean, he loves this stuff. He loves the worms, but I saw a greater joy in his eye when his little, you know, granddaughter ran up to him, take me on the tractor, and she wanted to pull a carrot. I mean, I'm crying right now because it's like so, it's just so heartfelt, you know, that's, you know, that's why he's living, and that's more importantly why he's, you know, turning this patch of land to leave something for his literally grandkids to make the world a better place, because surely people in power and many powers that be are not trying to save the planet and be more sustainable. We're actually using and consuming more than ever and generating more waste than ever. So you can stop that. You can make a difference today by, you know, don't send any more of your food waste off-site. Use it on-site. Figure out how to do it. This video will help you guys for sure. Anyways, if you guys enjoyed this episode at Arizona Worm Farm, hey, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up. More importantly, please be sure to share this video with somebody else so that they can see how some of the best worm castings are made in the country, and definitely the best castings in Arizona that I've seen to date. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you never miss out on my new and upcoming episodes that come out about every 5 to 7 days. You never know where I'll show up. Always be learning on my YouTube channel. And be sure to put a comment down below if you want me to come back to, you know, visit Zach in the future and what you want me to show, because I want to come back in the future and make videos on you know, how he grows the best worms to sell, and more importantly, also more about the black soldier flies that I just touched on in this video. I mean, he showed me the whole process on that, and that actually is extremely interesting to me, because actually the black soldier flies eat food waste even faster than the worms, okay, and make some good products that are valuable for gardeners as well. And finally, be sure to click the bell so you get notified as many new videos come out. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. The past episodes are a wealth of knowledge, over 1,500 episodes at this time on this YouTube channel, dedicated to teach you guys all the best aspects of how to grow your own food at home. I'll put a couple links to some videos I made at some of the other best worm farms that I've visited, including one in Texas and one in California that also make very high-grade worm castings, actually, that they will ship to you guys. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. Until then, remember, keep on growing.